Good evening, welcome. This is the Occupational Therapy Assistant Open House. We welcome you this evening for this event. Our students are very excited to entertain you, if you will, and present what occupational therapy is all about. In the month of April, we typically have an open house in order to have the community be aware of what we do, and also for the students that are interested in the program of occupational therapy. The program is an Associate of Science degree, and it takes about 2 years for the program to be completed. And we want to thank you for joining us this evening.
Hi, my name is Debbie Chasanoff, and I am the Program Director of the Occupational Therapy Assistant Program here at the State College of Florida. And I think they're going to ask me some questions.
We have a live interview. We're going to do a couple questions for Debbie, the Program Director. The first one is, in your own words, can you describe what occupational therapy is?
Occupational therapy is a health profession that works with individuals in participation of goal-directed activities to promote independence and control of their life skills. We work with people with a variety of different types of disabilities that can be caused from physical, social, emotional, cognitive deficits, and help them to develop the skills they need to do all their occupations that cross their day. And your occupations are everything you do from the minute you wake up to the minute you go to bed, so it includes things like basic skills to get yourself dressed and feed yourself, to more complex skills to be able to drive a car, to be able to go to work, to be able to handle your finances. So whatever their occupations are, we want them to be able to function in their areas. We also work across the lifespan, starting at our newest born babies all the way through our geriatric population.
All right, question two. How is the curriculum of the program set up?
The curriculum is set up as a problem-based curriculum. Our job is to help our students develop the skills they need to be occupational therapists and to be able to occupational therapy assistants in our profession. And we set it up so that they learn the information, they get to practice it in lab activities, and then they go out to clinical experiences to get to use those skills with real patients.
All right, question three. What is the pass rate of the program?
The pass rate is very high. Generally, over the last 10 years, we've been between 95% to 100% pass rate on the national certification exam, which is given by MBCOT.
All right, question four. How many students get accepted into the program each year?
Each year we accept 24 students into the program for a fall start. We just closed our application period for this fall coming up. Applications are only accepted one time a year between January 1st and March 1st, and then decisions are made in the spring and students are notified and they come in the fall.
Question 5. What kind of clinical settings are available for students in this program?
We have a wide variety of clinical settings to match the individuals that we work with, from pediatric to geriatric, adult rehab, hospital-based settings, school-based settings. Our clinical sites are focused in Manatee and Sarasota County, but we actually have a range of about an hour radius of the college. We go into Hillsborough, Pinellas, and south into Charlotte County as well.
Question 6. Do students get off their job while completing their clinicals?
Sometimes. It just depends on if there's an opening at their clinical site. But without a doubt, doing your clinical rotations, especially the last clinical rotation of the program, this is an opportunity for the students to work full-time in a healthcare or a clinical setting, and the staff get to know the student and get to know what their skills are. So it's not uncommon that students get offered a position at those facilities. It's a great recruitment tool for the facilities.
Question 7. What advice do you have for new students applying to this program to be successful?
I think the hardest thing about coming into this program is that you have to realize it's really a full-time program. The amount of time and commitment needed is probably close to 30 to 40 hours a week, which is different from most academic programs. And because our program includes a combination of class, laboratory, and clinical, the number of hours that they're actually in scheduled class time is much higher than an average full-time program. They have to rely on their support network, and they usually have to give something up in order to be a full-time student here. So you can't be doing everything you were doing before.
Question 8. Do you recommend students to keep their full-time or part-time job while in the program?
The program was designed for a student not doing anything except going to school, so it was not designed for a working student. However, we recognize that many of our students need to be able to work to support themselves throughout the program. So we recommend that students don't work more than 20 hours a week while in the program. We have had students work more, but they have to make compromises in their life in order to be able to get that work done for school as well as work in an outside setting.
All right, then that completes our live interview.
Okay, thank you very much. So throughout the program, please be sure to post any questions in the chat, and we will be sure to address them at the end of the program. Thank you for joining us, and now I'm pleased to introduce a message from the State College of Florida Retention Coordinator, Megan Rayner.
I hope you're getting excited about potentially being part of State College of Florida's OTA program. My name is Megan Renner, and I'm here to talk to you today a little bit about the admissions requirements prior to applying to our OTA program. So while you are only required to take a few courses, I'll also give you some tips and tricks of the trade to make you a better, more attractive applicant to the program. Make sure that before you apply to the program, you complete our anatomy and physiology level 1 and 2. You also need to make sure to complete a Mathematics Area 2 course. My suggestions for students are always a statistics course or college algebra. Now, if math may not be your favorite subject, we also have liberal arts math that may be a better option for you, but you can always come see an academic advisor to discuss. You also need to make sure you're completing ENC 1101, as well as Psych 2012, which is our Introduction to Psychology course. Now, while those are the only required courses before you apply to the OTA program at State College of Florida, we highly recommend that you complete more general education courses prior to applying. Remember, the GPA is also very important to your application process, so work very hard to receive above a minimum grade of C before you apply to the program. Again, remember, if you need any clarification on this, our advising team at the State College of Florida in our College of Career Planning office would be more than happy to assist you.
Hello, everyone. We're going to be taking a short 5-minute intermission, but stay tuned. When we come back, you'll be able to meet some of our current occupational therapy assistant students, like myself, and you'll be able to learn more about our program curriculum, as well as different applications that we have within our field. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to our State College of Florida Occupational Therapy Assistant Program open house. My name is Ashley. I am an Occupational Therapy Assistant student here at the State College of Florida, and I am here to tell you about our theme tonight for this open house. Our theme tonight is Occupational Therapy, putting the pieces of life together. We here at this program have felt throughout our 2 years here that basically occupational therapy is like one big puzzle, and we are putting the pieces of our life together, whether that includes our vision, our hearing, our physical appearance, as well as our mental appearance. We're going to be covering all of those different aspects today of the different puzzle pieces of life as we show you all the different interventions that we have through occupational therapy. So please enjoy.
So what is occupational therapy? Occupational therapy is a client-centered profession that is concerned with the health and well-being through occupation. Occupational therapy primary goal is to engage our patient to participate in activity of everyday life. So what does that mean? That means from the moment you wake up in the morning to the moment you go to bed, there's so many responsibility that each one of you have throughout the day. That may include waking up early in the morning, taking a shower, brushing your teeth, brushing your hair, preparing a meal, doing laundry, different home management. So all of this are things that are affecting our patient do in their everyday life. So we try as occupational therapy to get them to be more independent and safe while performing and engaging this different type of occupations.
All right, next we have six tables that are some of our current classmates are gonna be presenting with a bunch of different various interventions that occupational therapy assistants can help their patients and help them increase their independence in everyday tasks.
Andrea Pennefield, and we're both second year students at the State College of Florida for Occupational Therapy Assistant. Today our table is about work ergonomics. Does anybody know what work ergonomics is?
Oh, what is that?
So what is ergonomics? You will learn about it today. Ergonomics is about the study of people's efficiency in a working environment. A working environment can also be referred to as a workstation. So many people can think about, what is a workstation? So a workstation can be different things. So it can be you sitting in front of a computer in your office. It can be you cooking dinner for your family, or if you're a chef or a cook in the kitchen. Or it can also be you if you're in construction, working in the construction site. So your workstation is anywhere where you do your work. So for the purposes of this presentation, we actually chose as students to assess a workstation in front of a computer. So we have a picture here. And as you can see, this picture shows how most of us are guilty of sitting sometimes in front of a computer, slouching, putting a lot of stress on our lower back and maybe on our neck. And sometimes we don't even have our both feet on the floor. And then this is how we would all sit, or we would all want to sit. So it's not slouching, your back is straight, and both feet are on the floor. So this is what we always want to accomplish.
So I'm going to sit down here, and I would like if you guys could tell me what bad positions or postures I have.
So we're going to assess her workstation right now. So
her shoulders aren't straight back.
Can you spot what's wrong with her workstation, her position right now? Yes, her shoulders. What else?
Her feet are barely touching the floor.
Correct. Yep, her feet are barely touching.
The computer's not at eye level.
Mm-hmm. Yes, which is very important, which is causing her neck not to be, it's, you know, it's flexed. Yeah. What else? Well, and also, of course, his back is slouching, which is causing her lower back to get all the pressure. And then after that, we've all had that after we're working in front of a computer for a couple of hours, when we stand up, we can feel that on our lower back. So, some ways that we can fix this are we can raise our monitor screen. You can do this at home. If you don't have a stool, you can do it with a book, with a thick book. But for now, we're gonna use this. So look, immediately her neck is not like this anymore. So the laptop is at eye level. What else?
We'll need a keyboard, an external keyboard. Since our keyboard's up here, we wanna keep our arms down at our side.
A 90 degree angle.
And I would need a footstool because my feet are not flat on the floor.
Mm-hmm. So we have here. I know you can't see it from there, but this is what you can use. You can also use a box or a book, like I said.
And lumbar support for my back.
So we have a lumbar pillow here, which you can get them off Amazon.
And document holder.
Document holder. So, right here. So, how does her posture look now?
Much better.
Yes. How are you feeling, Amanda, now?
Oh, much better. My back feels wonderful.
Yep, I'm sure. Because mm-hmm. you took all the pressure of your lower back.
What's the purpose of a document holder?
Oh, so she doesn't have to constantly look down and type. That way, she just has to turn her head from side to side and she can type. Mm-hmm. So now you're wondering, so what do we do? What does OT have to do with any of this? So as OT practitioners, we come in, we assess your working environment, we give you suggestions to modify it, and we help employers prevent injuries from happening to their employees. Because that's basically what they want. They want their employees to be healthy and to come to work and have a nice and healthy environment so they can avoid injuries.
Safe environment.
Safe environment, exactly. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
My name is Tanya.
And I'm Jacqueline.
We're both occupational therapy assistant students. And today we're going to just go over some pediatric strategies with you. I'm doing inhibition and facilitation techniques. One may ask, what is facilitation? What is inhibition? Facilitation is a technique that we use. It's a fast, irregular motion, which I'm going to demonstrate here with my doll on a ball. It's just a fast, irregular motion that we use to stimulate muscle tone. So in patients that have a low tone, this is a technique that we can use. Other examples include vibration, brushing, Okay, and also then inhibition is another technique that we can use. And inhibition is a slow, repetitive motion. And here I'm going to demonstrate with some slow rolling. And with inhibition, it increases the muscle tone. So it's a nice, calming effect. There is other techniques. That's a good question. We have neutral warmth, which we ask that the parents just bring the child in already wrapped.
Nice warm blanket.
Nice warm blanket. There's slow rolling. There is
maintained pressure.
Mm-hmm. So less than body weight pressure.
Push the ball on their back.
Yep. And then we have our next strategy is bubbles. So bubbles is a great technique we also use, which helps
with sustained attention. Lord. It's good for your eyes and visual tracking to follow the bubbles. It's good for hand-eye coordination. We're reaching, we're popping bubbles.
Mm-hmm. Even range of motion.
Yep, and finger isolation. And also if a child needs to work on grasp, we can use any object toy. They can hold the toy, pop it with that. So there's that. Another activity you can do with kids, we have stuff called putty. We can also use Play-Doh for this, but with putty, they come in a couple different firmnesses. So like this one's really hard, but we'll use this nice one here. We can use this for hand strength, squeezing, pulling. We can also use it for some of the fine motor, like with fingers and stuff. We put beads inside of them. We hide them in there, and the kids have to dig through and use their fingers to find the beads inside and pull them all out.
What's fine motor?
That's fine motor. It's more of our finger muscles, like the muscles we would use.
It's called a pincer grasp. It's good for writing, you holding your pencil, your pen.
Your spoon.
Yep.
For eating.
Another fun activity we like to do with kids, which I need to set up.
Mm-hmm.
For pre-writing strokes, we have some milestone for kids. For children that are three, they should be able to make horizontal lines, vertical lines, and circles. So one really fun way to do it, shaving cream. Everyone loves to play with the shaving cream. So you just put it out here. We spread it around. And in there, they can use their fingers to do lines, horizontal lines, circles. We can also use, if you want to grab that paintbrush,
mm-hmm.
if they don't like touching it, we can also work on the grasp on a pencil or a pen and use a paintbrush.
Mm-hmm.
A cross, that's around age four. That's a milestone for a four-year-old to be able to do that.
X's.
That's age five. So there's a progression of milestones for pre-writing strokes. And another really good activity to do with kids is music. Music is self-regulation. They can match the speed of the music in their bodies to it. They can calm themselves, or it can increase if it's fast-paced music. We can strengthen body awareness, balance, coordination, and motor planning skills. So if everyone wants to stand up,
yeah.
We have a little song we're gonna do with you. Just sing along and dance along. Here we go.
Heads, shoulders, knees, and toes, knees and toes. Heads, shoulders, knees, and toes, knees and toes. Eyes and ears and mouth and nose. Heads, shoulders, knees, and toes, knees and toes.
Cool. So those are some of the activities that we can do with kids with disabilities in the classroom or in a clinic. Oh, sorry.
There's different diagnoses. There's kids with cerebral palsy, kids with Down syndrome.
There's developmental delays in children.
Mm-hmm.
Autism is a big one that we can really address and get them playing with some stuff. Sorry. Thank you.
Shelby. I'm also part of our Occupational Therapy Assistant program here at the State College of Florida.
And my name is Vanessa, and I'm a student here as well.
Our table is based on adaptive equipment, which is used for many occupations, ranging from self-care, such as brushing our hair, cutting our nails, all the way to leisure activities, such as playing cards. To start with, we would like you to attempt to try to bend over to put on shoes or pants without bending over. So for some of our patients, like those who have had orthopedic surgery, such as a hip replacement or a knee replacement, they have precautions where they are not able to bend over past 90. So I would recommend you try to do that without, you know, try to put on shoes or socks without bending over. So as you can tell, this could be a very hard thing to do when you're not able to bend. So occupational therapy practitioners like to recommend adaptive equipment that help our patients be able to perform these tasks as independently as possible. So the first item I have in my hand is a reacher. This can be used in many ways. When referring to dressing, we can use the hook on the bottom to help push off our socks or pick up our pants to pull them to a level where we don't have to bend over. Another item we have is a sock aid. This sock aid allows a patient to take their socks and put it on the piece of equipment, our sock aid. And as we like to say, go fishing for your foot. So the patient would use these ropes to lower it down to their feet, which you're not able to see right now, but they would be able to use the strings to pull the sock up their leg, and as that happens, the sock ends up on the patient's foot, allowing the sock aid to come off to be used for the other foot. This helps our patients avoid breaking those hip precautions. Another piece of equipment we might use is our leg lifter. This can be used to help a patient get their leg over a bathtub without breaking their hip precautions. So keeping that hip and knee in line without turning their toes inward, which is another one of their hip precautions. For a different type of patient who may have what we like to say is limited range of motion in the shoulder or arm area, there are different tools that can be used to assist in self-care, such as brushing your hair or using a comb. For someone who may have difficulty with more fine motor tasks, as our previous table had stated, there's different manipulative tools or adaptive equipment that can be used to button a shirt or zip up your jacket. What other kind of stuff do we have?
All right, so as you can imagine, somebody with physical and neurological deficits may have a hard time with eating, which is something that is very, very important. So we have a few devices here that would help an individual when they have trouble eating. The first thing we have here is a plate with suction cups on the bottom. When somebody is unable to use one of their hands, this device is awesome because they're able to just suction it onto the table and just use one hand to feed, which allows them to, they don't need to steady the plate with their other hand. We also have a weighted spoon here. Individuals with Parkinson's have tremors, so you can imagine it would be hard to eat soup, applesauce, some liquid food. So this weighted spoon helps keep their arms steady and it helps them be able to eat those types of things. We have a swivel spoon here, which is awesome for people who are not able to supinate and pronate their hand. So it keeps the spoon steady so they don't have to turn their hand inward to eat.
What do you mean supinate?
So supination and pronation is just the turning of your forearm, either down, which would be pronate, or supinate, which is up. A good way to remember that is holding a bowl of soup. That's our fun way to do it.
Awesome job, Shelby. All right, another device we have here is a very important when you are in an educational setting. It is a yellow overlay. This device helps children with intellectual deficits stay track of where they are reading. So they hold this up to the line that they are trying to stay focused on, and it helps them keep reading from left to right. And something that is very important to me are leisure activities. Individuals who are unable to grasp their hands or anything are unable to hold cards or play their games. So we have devices like this right here, which holds your cards for you, so you don't have to hold them. So we have devices that are important for eating, for your leisure activities, and just for your dressing and everyday life.
We're going to take a 5-minute intermission. During this time, go ahead and search your house for a cotton ball, paper clip, dime, and a quarter and a key. When we come back, I'll introduce our sensory exercise table. See you shortly.
Hi, my name is Hannah. I'm one of the OTA students here at SCF.
Hi, my name is Lynn. I'm an OTA student at the State College of Florida.
And our table is on the different senses of the body and how OTs can assess them.
So everybody knows the five basic senses, touch, taste, smell, vision, and auditory. But there's three other senses as well, vestibular, proprioception, and interoception. So vestibular sense is your sense of balance. Proprioception is where and how your body is moving. So if an individual has an impaired proprioception sense, they may have trouble walking and may often fall because they don't know how their legs are moving. Interoception sense is your internal body sense. So that gives you information from your nervous system and your organs. So being able to coordinate your breathing after a long run is an example of that.
So there are many different types of senses, but today we're going to be talking about touch and specifically stereognosis. And for those of you who do not know what that is, it's the ability to identify an object only by touch without visual or auditory input. And an example of that in real life is like if you're looking through a bag for your phone or your keys or your wallet without actually looking into the bag. And the types of patients that we assess this skill on are those who have had a stroke, or those who have Parkinson's, just basically any disease or disorder that affects the nervous system, because typically they have issues with stereognosis, and that is called astereognosis, which is the inability to identify an object just by touch without visual or auditory input.
So now I'm gonna assess Hannah's stereognosis with the items we asked you to get before intermission. So before you start, you want to have the patient identify each item with vision. Then you want to have the patient identify each item in their hand without vision. So,
a paperclip, a quarter, a dime, a key, and a cotton ball.
So you want to make sure that the person's vision is hidden because you don't want them to cheat while they're taking the assessment. Okay. So I'm going to place an item in your hand, so please identify what it is.
Okay. A key.
Correct.
A cotton ball.
Correct.
Is there a particular order you have to go in?
No.
Okay. This is the dime. This is a quarter. And the paperclip.
Correct.
So this is a pain scale. It's the Wong and Baker pain scale, and we use these a lot with our patients. It goes from a number of 0, which means no pain at all, they're comfortable, all the way up to 10, which is like the worst pain possible, like I need to go to the hospital right now. And this just helps the patients communicate how they're feeling effectively.
So to sum it all up, we use different senses every day without even realizing it, like stereognosis. So as OTAs, we have to be able to identify if a patient has an impaired sensation, how would it affect their occupations of daily living? Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Alexa.
And my name is Tiffany.
And we are OTA students at the State College of Florida. All right, so today we're going to be talking to you all about low vision.
All right, so low occupational therapists can help client, or occupational therapy, can help clients with low vision in a variety of ways. That includes recommendations and teaching them the use of different supplies and equipment, devices, recommendations for adaptations to their home environment, as well as recommendations for community resources. And so there's a lot of different diseases and diagnoses that cause low vision. Some of the major ones in the US that occupational therapists work with include macular degeneration, glaucoma, and diabetic retinopathy. So Alexa's just gonna hold up some pictures and we're just gonna zoom in a little bit. These pictures are showing exactly what clients with these different type of diseases and diagnoses see in their field of vision, basically on a day-to-day basis. So with macular degeneration, basically that's damage to the retina of the eye. So their central vision is occluded. That means what they see directly in front of them, they have difficulty seeing, but they are able to see the sides of their vision, or what we call peripheral vision. With macular degeneration, they also have issues with visual acuity. And visual acuity is just being able to distinguish specific details on objects or patterns, and also difficulty with contrasting colors. You know, being able to see, a light colored cup on a light surface would be difficult for these clients. And then the next one is glaucoma. That's the opposite of macular degeneration. We call this tunnel vision. Basically, they can see objects directly in front of them, but their peripheral vision, the vision that's on the sides of their body, is occluded and they're unable to see. So again, this is an example of tunnel vision or glaucoma. And then the last picture is diabetic retinopathy. We call this spotty vision, and basically they have hemorrhaging in the back of their eye, which occludes different spots in their field of view. So basically I can see your hands and your t-shirt, but I may not necessarily be able to see your hair and your eyes. And you can see this here, some of the pictures occluded, but you can still see a little bit on the sides of their face. So as far as like adaptations to their home environment, again, that has to do with, if clients have difficulty with seeing contrast colors, basically an example would be for like meal planning. We have this bright colored plate here. This is a yellow plate, and we can suggest for them to put this on top of a dark surface, like a dark colored mat, so they're able to see their plate a lot better. And then also we can use reflective tape. We can put reflective tape in different areas of their home, like on their closet or the bathroom, to help them be able to find where these areas are in their home. And then as you see, there's numbers on this plate. That's just another method that we use to help them to designate certain areas of the plate of where they can put food, to help them remember what food items are where. So if they go to a restaurant, they can just say, or in ALF or residential facility, they can say, I would like my meat to always be at 6 o'clock, at 6 o'clock, or I would like my vegetables to always be at 9 o'clock, to help remember where these food items are.
Okay, another home modification that we can do. So a client with low vision, if they were to grab this out of their cabinet, they would have a hard time reading the label. So what we can do is we can attach a index card and write it in big font, and it'll help them be able to see it easier. Other things that we can do for individuals with low vision is we can give them like larger dominoes so that they can still participate in leisure activities. We can also give them larger cards, and then we also have different magnifiers that we can give to them as well. Okay. So I have an app that I wanted to show you guys. It is called, I know, you guys can download this from the App Store. And basically what it does, can you hold this up?
Yep.
EYE note.
Yes, EYE note, E-Y-E note. So I'm gonna have Tiffany hold up the dollar bill and I scan it and it tells me what the dollar bill is worth. So it's $10, okay? So now we're gonna talk to you about this money method.
Okay, so the American Institute for the Blind has developed a method for identifying bills inside of the wallet. And it's basically a method that's used in the US. So what I would like for you to do is if you have any bills in your pocket or wallet, or if you just have a sheet of paper, you can try this out. So if you have low vision and you wanna know what did I just pull out of my hand, and let's say you can't use the app, what you can do is just feel in your hand and you'll know that if your bill is straight out like this, then you're holding a dollar. All right, and then if your bill is folded in half, your money's folded in half, excuse me, we call it like a hamburger, then you know that you're holding a $5 bill. All right, and then if you fold it long ways, we say like a hot dog, then you know you're holding a $10 bill, or you pulled a $10 bill out of your wallet. And then lastly, an example is a $20 bill. With the $20 bills, you fold it in half like a hamburger, and then again like a hot dog, and that's how you know that you've just pulled a $20 bill out of your wallet.
All right, so to close everything up, we wanted to leave you guys with a resource. There is a resource called the Lighthouse Vision Loss Education Center, and it is a great resource for different things for individuals with vision loss, and I encourage you all to look it up on your own time and really see the amazing things that they're doing in the community.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Kate, and I am an occupational therapy assistant student here at the State College of Florida, and this is one of my fellow classmates.
My name is Julio Fabra. I'm also a student at the State College of Florida.
So today at our table or center, we're going to talk to you about assessments we do here in occupational therapy and how our assessments from physical assessments tie in to also mental health and how occupational therapy plays a role in mental health in our communities.
As you may have heard in previous presentations, there was an awful lot of the use of assessments. Now we as occupational therapy assistants, we assist the occupational therapy in coming up with a program and a way of being able to assess a person. Now what does that mean? Basically, the moment we meet our client or we see them in the room or they're lying in bed, that's when we start to begin noticing certain things. How do they get up? What do they move like? What is their body motions are doing. And from that, we can have an idea of how well they move or not move, what their limitations are. Now, that only goes so far. We have to back that up. In order to back that up, we have to use different tools. The different tools that are at our disposal, among many, is we have a goniometer. Okay, this little device, it's very helpful. Say, for instance, you notice that your patient is reaching, you tell them, can you reach for that cupboard? But they can only go so far. Well, this is great. Okay, you can see they're not really mobile. They can't go any higher. But you need to back that up. So basically what you need to do is you measure, okay? So you take the goniometer, you place it here and here, and you get a reading of what it is that they're able to do with that. Now that then, you're able to extrapolate from that whether they fall within a certain functional limit. Okay, so say for instance, if she was able to only move that far, you know that say for instance, if you were to do this at home, you could go like this. So obviously if this person can only hear, there's a problem. That's a way to assess it. That's the way we kind of look at it and go, okay, that's the way it can move. That's movement. There's also different ways that we take for granted the way you pick up your key, the way you turn a key into a keyhole. You may not think about it, but some people can't do it. Why is it they can't do it? They lack strength. So there's ways of measuring that. There's different ways of doing that. We have this gauge that tells us how much strength they have. Different fingers, different grips, different ways of doing that. Because again, these are things we take for granted, but other people who have limitations may not. There's also different ways.
How are you measuring their strength?
Pardon me?
How are you measuring their strength?
Basically what we do, this gives us an idea. So what we do is we tell them, say for instance, we notice that they're not able to hold like something like this way or this way, right? So what we do is we tell them to take this. I'm sorry, just talking to you. Okay, so you take this and you tell them to pinch it. And then what it'll tell you is right here what it is that the readout is. You tell them to do it again, and therefore you're able to extrapolate from that what it is that their functional strength is.
So that's what is the readout in?
What is the readout in?
Mm-hmm.
It's pounds.
And you'll take the average of your three numbers, and that's the number you would log on their report or give to your OTR occupational therapy therapist, like overseer, and that's what they would put on their report.
What I was gonna do next is basically show you here is something again that we have a grip, right? We grip things, we don't really think about it. People have limitations with that. So we have to assess how strong are they. Again, we do the same thing. We take this, we tell them to hold it in a very specific way so they can hold it and do it. You do an average of three, and then we measure that, and then we are able to extrapolate what it is that their average strength is with their grip. So that's another way to measure that.
What do you do, squeeze that thing?
Yes.
Oh. And what's that called?
A dynamometer. Dynamometer?
Dynamometer.
So, also the reason and the importance of these numbers is the fact that as occupational therapists or any medical practice, we all bill to insurance unless special situations of independent pay. Billing to insurance, you have to prove, or for any doctor, that your patient is improving or there's no real reason for them to be there. These devices and assessment tools, whether it be the physical devices or what I'm about to talk to you about, written assessments, are solid data that you can refer to later on to show that ways your patient has improved or if they need to be discharged back home because there's no improvement being made. So also, our assessments range into verbal assessments or even written assessments, and one of those being mental health assessments. So in our mental health assessments, I'm gonna talk to you about the Canadian Occupational Performance Measure. This is an assessment to be very client-centered. So as an occupational therapist, you wanna choose assessments client-centered and find information out through your assessments about your patients to encourage them to work within treatment. So some of the questions that the Canadian Occupational Performance Measure asks is about your self-care. So it's gonna ask you about areas that you are unhappy with currently in your self-care. So that can be dressing, grooming, bathing, and you're gonna rate it, the client will rate their level of unhappiness in that performance on a scale of 1 to 10. So after you go through all the areas of self-care, personal care, functional mobility, community mobility, you'll go to productivity, paid or unpaid work, areas are having difficulty in the level of importance to them, household management, and then school and play, which are basically going through all our areas of occupation. And then you'll take that list of areas of unhappiness, 1 to 10, their scores, and then ask them what their personal occupational performance problems are, 1 through 5. And then that's how you will create a client-centered treatment plan and follow that with your patient so that you are helping them get the most out of their therapy. So also this semester, we worked on mental health in different classes, and you'll work on and learning about more about mental health and the assessments that go along with it throughout the program. So coming up are mental health presentation posters, but before that, we're gonna take another 5-minute break, and we'll see you shortly. Thank you.
Welcome back. My name is Joe. I'm an occupational therapy assistant student, State College of Florida. And as Kate stated, we have mental health projects to kind of demonstrate how occupational therapy can help with the mental health side of therapy. And for our poster, we had Corinne Otini's treatment for depression and anxiety. And due to COVID-19, individuals have been stuck in their homes to quarantine, and this has increased depression and anxiety. And since mid-March, alcohol sales have gone up 55% from individuals just trying to cope with their depression and anxiety by leaning to alcohol. And how occupational therapy can help is we can educate on adapting existing routines and create new ones to try to help a more healthy lifestyle, and involve the client in social activities and have them maintain connection with others, teach mindfulness and relaxation techniques, discuss and identify negative effects of alcohol on the client's life, and a few coping strategies that we can teach and educate the patient on is exercise daily, eat a balanced diet, get enough sleep, take deep breaths and breathing exercises, and maintain a positive attitude, and staying connected with friends and family via FaceTime or Zoom or any other platform. And one application to the real world would be applying anxiety reliefs such as breathing techniques in a situation where you would normally be stressed out in, and hopefully that can help you relax and calm down. Thank you.
So for my presentation for the mental health project that we did in class last semester was how can we use toys in OT. So toys can be more than just a toy, right? So how many times have you guys gone to Walmart and have seen a toy that represent a type of disability? Not much, right? So how can we use inclusive dolls in OT? So the way we can use OT to help these children, we can help advise toy maker an additional accessory or care to provide toy maker input. We could encourage the use of inclusive toys in schools to promote inclusivity and acceptance. We can also reduce that feeling of depression and anxiety surrounding medical intervention and procedures that children may go through. Okay. So how can we apply this information in the real world? Children can be hospitalized, they might have a feeding tube. So the way we can use toys in this case is that we can teach them how to properly care for their feeding tubes. Some children may have diabetes and they may have to inject insulin. So they can use these toys to practice injecting insulin so they can be able to do it themselves. So that was basically our idea for this project.
Hi everyone, my name is Sherry and I'm an occupational therapy assistant student here at the State College of Florida. Our topic is Go Mom, how can OT support moms with special needs children during a pandemic? So basically, during the pandemic, mothers have experienced increased stress, anxiety, and depression levels due to school closures and job closures and having to be home and not only be a mother, but provide educational pursuits for their children during schoolwork. So they're experiencing increased stress, anxiety, and depression. There's a little chart here which you can't really see, but it's affecting all areas of occupation, like their personal hygiene, their meal prep, all that stuff. They're probably not paying much attention to it during this time because of the stress that they're focusing on, you know, helping their kids with their schoolwork online and all that kind of stuff. So how we can help is by teaching techniques for coping with stress and anxiety, such as practicing breathing techniques, recommending support groups, and how to handle emotional needs of special needs children, such as maintaining structure. For real-world practice, we can have the mom create a list of priorities and rank them from the most important to the least important to prioritize where they need to focus their energy to help their students and themselves and decrease stress and help maintain function in their household. So that's just the quick overrun of that. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
So the topic that my group focused on, we titled it Screen, Screen, What Do You See? So all of us throughout the pandemic have spent a lot of time on screens, whether that be engaging in video chat with our family, video chatting for work, video chatting into school, and class and whatnot. So that has started this whole new trend of a lot of us spending a lot more time staring at ourselves through a video chat screen, which is not as flattering filter as Snapchat is, and whatnot. So this has created a mental health issue around body image. How does occupational therapy help with this? What we're doing is we can restructure your routine. How can we help you eliminate this new self-consciousness that an individual might have seen? We can help with improving self-esteem, going over your daily routine, going through your work productivity now that you are on the screen, and that might be taking away from paying attention to the meeting going on around you, and whatnot. So for my group's presentation, what we focused on, as I said earlier, was body image through the new screen of video chatting and conferencing and the work setting, school setting, and most all areas of occupational therapy. And ways we can help resolve that for you, for an individual, would be looking at their routine, work productivity, the expectations to be on those video calls, and things of that nature. So with that being said, that's a wrap for our presentations, and we're now going to go to some questions for you guys that you have submitted on the chat.
And these posters will also be revealed in the library, so if you would like to, you can go check them out yourself and see a little bit more detail than we were able to provide for you at this moment.
And if you have questions, put them in the chat bar.
Hello everyone, welcome back. Again, my name is Ashley. I'm here with Kate, Shelby, and Julio. We're here to answer some of your questions that we had throughout the night in our chat, as well as answer some frequently asked questions that we have about occupational therapy.
All right, so the first question is, what are the hours that students will be in the classroom per week?
So there's different variations of hours that happen throughout our program throughout the 2 years. During the first year, you're only on campus several hours a day. So, and it also varies how many days you're here, because it depends on which class, because we have anatomy as well as intro to occupational therapy. You could be here for anywhere from 1 to 3 hours a day. And it also varies into our second year where you are also doing clinical work, where you're doing their full-time on-the-job training, and you're only here one day a week just for several hours to meet with your professor.
All right, second question. Is occupational therapy involved with patients who are blind?
Yes, so when looking at occupational therapy, blindness would just be one of their diagnoses. You can still have patients that became blind from a stroke. They can become blind from natural aging. They could have had a traumatic brain injury that has led to blindness. So having a diagnosis or a deficit of being blind is just one of the possible conditions we work with, and we're still going to improve someone's quality of life regardless of what any of their diagnoses would be.
Okay. Third question. Can you become an OT after becoming an OTA?
So the answer to that question is yes. There are many bridge programs. There's, I think, three in Florida itself. And these bridge programs range from about 2 to 2.5 years that will help an OTA make that next step to OT. Some employers do offer to pay maybe half the tuition depending on where you work. But yes, it is definitely a possibility.
Okay. The next question. What is the difference between an OT and an OTA?
The difference between an OT and an OTA is that the two work together. the OT is the person that first of all assesses and with you the client and looks at what the problems are. They come up with a program, and you as the OTA can have input in that. And what happens is then you and the OTA work in collaboration in coming up with an intervention for that person, depending on what the diagnosis is and what it is that you're going to be able to do. A lot of the times, what'll happen is the OT will come up with this plan, and it'll be up to the OTA to actually carry it out.
Can you talk about the degree difference between an OT and an OTA?
The degree difference?
The degree difference between an occupational therapist and an occupational therapy assistant is, for an occupational therapy assistant, it is a 2-year associate in science degree, whereas now with an occupational therapist, it is now a master's degree to be able to decipher the difference between those.
So, out of how many students that apply to the program actually get accepted?
That
I know last year, we don't know the exact numbers because there were 24 that got accepted, mm-hmm. but out of all the applicants, we don't have an exact number.
That is typically the number, is 24. We typically get well over 100 applicants every year, but 24 is the number.
What is the drop rate of this program?
I'd say that our dropout rate is usually due to other factors outside of the program, not necessarily tied to the program itself. I know our group itself started out with, I think, 4 other people that have dropped for family reasons or commute reasons, but none of which were from academic reasons. So we retain a lot of our students.
Will this presentation be available to share offline?
Yes, this presentation tonight will all be able to be shared online. You'll be able to access it on the State College of Florida Facebook page. It was recorded the entire time. We did this so that some of our new applicants are able to see, even though they were in class, as well as some of our first-year students that were not able to make it tonight as well, so they can see what they can look forward to for the rest of their coming years at the OTA program. Thank you, everyone.
We want to thank you for joining us this evening. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. You can learn more about us at scf.edu/OTA or give us a call here on campus at 941-752-5050. We hope to see you soon at the State College of Florida. Thank you very much.